Romans chapter 7. Snicker and laugh. And I remember looking out of the corner of my eye and I saw Cheryl in the corner crying. Somebody later on asked her why she was crying, and she said, "Everybody's laughing at me." Now, I knew that everybody wasn't laughing at Cheryl. But I also knew I was one that did. And I remember riding the bus back home, and I sat in the seat next to the window and looking out and going over in my head how I had hurt you. I did. I wasn't the only one, but I did. And on the way home, I remember asking myself over and over and over again, why did I do that? Why did I do that? Y'all, that's my story. There are other ones. I ain't going to tell you all of them. Here's something I know, though. At some point in time in your life, you've asked the same question. You've done something, and when it was all said and done, after the damage was done, you asked yourself, why did I do that? And so today, this message will help you. It'll help you with that. To answer that question, why did I do that? And in verse 14 of this text, it says that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal. If you had just read in verse 12, it said that the law itself is holy, just, and good. But now we're reading that the law is a spiritual thing, and I am a carnal, fleshly thing. I'm a product of my flesh. But watch it. It says this. It says, there's a key word in there that you have to, if you really want to get the essence, the flavor in what Paul was trying to say to us here, there's a key word that you have to bring out and listen to. Look, it says this. The law is spiritual, but that word is key to understanding what it's saying there. It said but, because when you say but, it says now we are about to expose the flip side, the other side. It says the law is spiritual, but I, on the flip side of the spiritual, I am carnal. You got to understand, church, that there is a very real war between the flesh and the spirit. It's raging within you. You are the battleground. And both the flesh and the spirit want to plant a victory flag in you. Bugs Bunny said it this way. I remember that he and Yosemite Sam had this thing going. And Yosemite thought that he had got over on Bugs Bunny. But Bugs Bunny turned and looked at the camera and he said, "This means war." What he's saying is that there is an ongoing conflict. An ongoing conflict. And in this conflict, you might lose some battles. But the only thing that matters is that in the end, you're still standing. Yo, that's what I love about being a soldier in the army of the Lord. In the end, if y'all don't know, in the end, we win. Well, we win. You might be bumped and bruised along the way, but I can already tell you it's okay. You can go ahead and claim the victory because we serve in the army of the Lord. I can sing a song that says, "Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today, right now, in the midst of everything going on. Victory is mine." I can tell Satan, "Get behind." Why? Because the victory is already mine. Nonetheless, church, the struggle is very real.
Yes, it is.
It's a war between the flesh and the spirit. It is not a fiction. It is fact. And sometimes it causes us to scratch our head and ask, why did I do that? Verse 18 helps us to understand. It helps us to understand. It says this in verse 18. It says, "In me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing." You see, after the fall of man, mankind could say, "Good don't live here anymore." I remember a man came to Jesus and he said, "Good master." And Jesus responded to him. He said, why do you call me good? He said, "There is none good except one, and that's God." He was referring to the fact that there is, in fact, this raging war inside of us. But eventually, church, guess what? You have to pick a side. God wants you to choose him. You know, the only thing that he's ever really wanted, the only thing that God ever really wanted was to be able to spend eternity with a creation that would voluntarily choose him. Voluntarily. Not because you have to, not because somebody told you this is what you ought to do, that of your own free will you decide this, even this very moment, the only thing that God really wants from you, the only thing that he wants from you is for you to voluntarily choose him. That's all he wants. But eventually, church, understand you are going to have to pick a side. Just a moment ago, I already told you who wins. I told you.
It would have been interesting and exciting if he had lost some
who wanted Golden State to win the series, but they wanted them to lose the game. Because they wanted the series to be interesting and exciting. Yo, that's our problem. That's our problem. We want things to be interesting. We want things to be exciting. But we're convinced that good isn't interesting.
You
already know that. It doesn't matter if I tell you that Sunday school and Bible study are the ways for you to deepen your relationship with the God who loves you unconditionally. It's a way for you to get to know Him. It's a way for you to be able to increase your faith in Him so that when you go through your moments, you can hold on and know who you're holding on to. It doesn't even matter. None of it really matters. Why? Because what you want is something that's interesting to your flesh. You decided that studying the Word of God is boring. And you decided that you're not going to do it. I'm right. I know. And guess what? On Wednesday at 11 o'clock and Wednesday at 7 o'clock, you will prove me right. You'll prove me right. It'll be Wednesday at 7 o'clock and Bible study will begin and you won't be there.
She heard
the voice of Satan. But she listened. She listened to the voice of self as it was influenced by the voice of Satan. So we can't say that the devil made me do it. Whenever you, as a child of God, whenever you sin, understand God has already spoken to you. And when you do it as a deliberate act of disobedience. Paul says that when I mess up, I don't do it, but the sin inside of me does. But what he said, I'm born again. I'm born again. And since I'm born again, I'm a new creature in Christ. There's a new me. But also, since I'm living in this flesh. And this flesh is positively inclined to evil. That's the old me. And good and evil are living within me at the same time, and they both want to be recognized. So when I mess up, it's not the new me doing it, it's just the residual effects of the old me still on the job. So that's why I do what I do. But what do I do about it? Take action, church. You take action. I can hear Paul speak words of action to the church of Philippi. He said, brother, I have to forget those things which are behind me. And I've got to reach forward to those things which are before me. So I press toward the mark of the high prize of God in Christ Jesus. Y'all, that's an action call. That's an action call. You're going to have to labor for a while after that prize. You're going to have to labor. I don't know, church, if you've ever had to press for anything in your life. I don't know if you ever. Because they because he stayed dead on Saturday. Your labor is not in vain, but early on a Sunday morning. It was early on Sunday morning that death couldn't hold him down anymore. Victory was yours and mine on Sunday morning. Victory was ours. Death had lost its sting on Sunday morning because early on Sunday morning, church, God raised him from the dead. And now he sits on the right hand of the Father, making intercession for you and for me. The same Jesus sits on the right hand of the Father.
Yes, he does.
The same one who said, I go away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away, I will come again. Church, he said, I will come again. Why? To receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Church, he's coming back.
Yes, yes.
Jesus is coming back. He's coming back for a church without a spot or wrinkle. He's coming back for you, and he's coming back for me. And so in the meantime, we've got to examine ourselves, even when we ask the question,